Live out of Miami, Fort Lauderdale, welcome to the Victor Arocho Show, co-hosted with Byron Jones, brought to you today by The Sportscast. Today's Thursday, October 8th. If you haven't yet, please subscribe to all our channels, YouTube, Periscope, iTunes, and if you're on iTunes, please leave a rating and review. It'll help us out tremendously. You can also visit us on the Sports Nest, on the sportscast.net. I'm tongue twisted today. Or follow us on Twitter at the sportscast1. Well, today I want to welcome in Byron. Byron, how you doing today, buddy?
Oh, wonderful in chilly Philadelphia.
Really? So I'm sure we're going to be talking about Tulsa a little bit. In today's show, we're going to be talking about obviously the NFL. We have a special guest, a guest on our show today. We're going to talk about the NFL rules and how they've evolved, good, bad, the ugly, and why do they seem so focused on defense. I talked a little bit about the Pats and Chiefs game. We're definitely going to always talk about the Giants. And then I want to make a comment about, you know, where the Cowboys really should be. And I want to find out on our team here is, like, who do they think is the best undefeated team? Then we're going to flip over to college for a little bit, give some love to Byron for Tulsa against UCF. I'm gonna let him color commentate that, and then we'll talk a little bit about the NBA finals, and we'll be wrapping up our show. If you have any calls, text or tweet, we'll be sure you're back for today. So, hey, Byron, how you doing today? You ready to get it on? How's everything?
I am doing great. The University of Tulsa lives again.
We'll get to that in a little bit, but right now let's introduce our host, our special guest, my best friend, my brother, our fellow Jersey boy, Benny Rivera. A little bit about Benny. Benny has officiated football for over the past 30 years. He's a practice official with one of the local NFL teams. He's also a replay analyst. For on-screen officials for major TV networking. Maybe I messed that up, Ben. You help me out with that. He's also, as my fellow co-host, has been in law enforcement. He's a retired 30-year law enforcement officer. And I thank him, and I obviously thank Byron for all the work. So he's a wealth of knowledge on football, the rules and regulations, and the signs, and everything it has to do with taking a rep. Well, welcome here to the sports show on Sportscast. How you doing, Benny?
I'm doing good. Thanks for having me. It's good to see Byron. I haven't seen Byron in about 3 years. Last time I saw you was down in Atlantic City.
Yes, it was.
Yeah.
Atlantic City. What were you guys doing in Atlantic City?
Police Expo.
Yeah, I'm sure that was no good.
Spending other people's money.
Yep. Well, prior to the show, we have a pre-show beforehand, and obviously we know each other. All of us are representatives of Perth Amboy, New Jersey, proud Middlesex County people, and I had to slow these two down because they were already ready to start getting on each other regarding just playing sports and stuff in the past. So, Benny, we welcome you. I'm sure you and Byron had some good times. You guys played a lot together, so we want to get into the show. So, you got anything to say to Byron right now?
No, it's great to see you.
Yeah, he looks good, doesn't he?
Looks great. But besides, you couldn't get me to ID to get onto the show.
All right, that's making fun. That's my fault. Relax there. You know, you can read rules and regulations, but you can't read your emails.
You didn't send me an email. You sent me a
sent. It would help that if you nothing else. Two fingers when you're typing. It helps.
Yeah, Benny. So, Benny, let me ask you a question. All right, let's get off the technical stuff. We know that, you know, it's COVID. We're trying to learn some of the things. So, Ben, let me ask you a question, right? We're going to get into the NFL. You have enough knowledge just in general. But as a ref, how have you seen the rules since, like, when we played all the way to now? And you know, what are the good, the bad, and the ugly? You know, obviously we had that incident with the Super Bowl and the pass interference. So, what kind of – can you shed some light on the rules and stuff and your thoughts on that?
The majority of the rule changes have been for safety issues. Like in college and the NFL, they're trying to take out that big hit that hurts people, the concussions. That was the main concern. That's why you're seeing when we played, those great hits well, they're not great anymore. We would be thrown out of games every day because we try to kill people. And they want to remove that from the
game. In a legal manner.
Right? In a legal manner, correct.
But legal, hit perfect hit, right? Right, Byron?
Yes, it was. Always perfect.
Okay.
So basically, it's the majority of rule changes are good for safety. And then as you move up in the ranks, in the NFL, it's an offensive game. The public wants to see scoring. So that's why there's more restrictions on a defensive player than an offensive player, because they want that 35-33 game coming down in the fourth quarter with Tom Brady, Aaron Rodgers having the ball in the last 2 minutes. So, you know, it's going to favor that. Plus, it's TV ratings. It's where the money is.
Interesting. So, let me delve into that. So you know, Byron, you played at a high level as a DN, D tackle. You know, how do you see that would have been how things would have affected how you play now, right? Because, you know, you're attacking the quarterback and your boys behind you are getting limited even more, right? Because it's all about the speed. What are your thoughts?
Well, probably. I think I would have been thrown out of many games. you know, back in the day, you know, what we were taught, Kurt Danboy, Tulsa, you know, coming up, get the ball carry, hold him up, and here come the troops, and go ahead and light him up. But I'm pretty sure, you know, Benny, that that's probably not allowed to hold the guy up and then, you know, three, four, five guys, you know, take an extra shot at him.
Now, we try to limit that now. Once you stop them, hold them up, we're calling it dead. Forward progress is done, and we're putting the ball down. It's for the safety of the players.
So what you're saying is basically like the great Pittsburgh Steelers defenses of the 70s and the Dallas Cowboys, you know, defenses, they probably wouldn't be as, you know, successful, you know, in these days?
They would be successful because you've played at that high level. You adapt, you overcome, and you figure it out. You're going to make mistakes. You're going to, you know, but you learn from them. And yeah, you got to adapt because that's your life. That's what you're going to do. So that's what the majority of pro athletes have been doing. They're adapting to the rules.
That's a good question because, you know, hold on 1 second. With the finals happening, because that's a good question, Byron and Benny. I'm not sure if I'm on the same page with you on that. Only because. Look at the way basketball is played. Some of those fouls that are called are ridiculous. I mean, Jordan got beat up. I mean, they got beat up. The Shaq attack, right? These guys got beat. Those were fouls. The fouls that I see today.
You weren't bleeding. It wasn't a foul. That was how we were.
No blood, no foul, right? Okay. But so it has to affect, you know, how one would play. I mean, you know, Steph Curry, and I love, you know – Steph Curry, right? And Klay Thompson. But, you know, can you imagine Steph Curry getting hit by one of those guys, by Rodman or those back then? Exactly. I'm just wondering, Benny, that it, those rules could have affected some of those guys, like those Raider defense in Pittsburgh, because they were scary mean. Like, they hated people. Alzado.
The Deacon Jones with the head slap. That changed the rule. They stopped having the head slaps. Alzado was just a total animal. But he had quarters in his hand pads smacking people in the head.
Gastineau?
You know. And you got to also look at the blocking. You know, they want to protect the guy's knees. So now there's not that much blocking below the waist, only in a free blocking zone and close line contact.
Crazy.
Yeah. I know, like when I played, you know, the one thing our defensive line coach used to always stress, don't go upfield, go down the line. Because if you go up the field, you're going to get cut. Yeah. It was plenty of times I was like, you know, that don't work. Yeah, you know, that's nothing going to happen. And I would go up the field, and we, you know, we had the knee brace and everything back then. And when you got after practice, you look at it, you could see that your knee brace was bent from that guy cutting you.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You know, and so I got one question though. We were all defensive players, right? And we played almost all three each position. I think the only, and I could be wrong, the position that is affected the least has been the linebacker position. like in the level of the three levels, right? You got the D line, you got the linebackers, and then you got the D backs, right? To me, I think the linebackers are the rules haven't affected them as much as it affects the front and the back. What are your guys' thoughts?
Well,
I'll tell you why, but I want to hear from you.
Well, I think the rules affect them all, not equally. But the linebackers, they get away with a lot more because it's harder to see the linebackers because they get lost in the forest between the line and the D-backs and the receivers. So when you get in that crossing route and you get that linebacker grabbing a jersey, sometimes you're going to get him, sometimes you're not. If he's within the chuck zone, within five yards, and then he keeps riding that guy out, then he's going to get ICT called on him.
Well, I'm not looking for more of the holding the shirt. I'm talking about because of their distance, right? They're still able to, like the Lawrence Taylor, I don't think he'd be affected in every error. Because of his position, right? Because he's at a short running position, his ability to hit without ducking his head as much, right? He's covering limited receivers because the D-backs is like they get charged for a pass interference for nothing, right? And then they don't call anything. When it's a real pass interference, they don't call it, right? But the linebacker is a little bit free reign. He's not full tilt. The D-linemen, you know, they're trying to hit and get they possibly can, but then they got to pull up based on what the quarterback has to do. Byron, I mean, you know, at what point do you like, hey, you know, you got to stop. You're trying to stop, but.
Once you get, you know, you're getting that 7 or 8 yard run at the quarterback and, you know, you see him, you know, your mouth, you know, you're salivating at the mouth because, you know, you're going to get this guy. And next, you know, he gets rid of the ball that split second and you whiff at him or whatever. Next, you know, the flag is flying up in the air. You're like, oh, what the hell? Like,
That was Benny's fault.
It's the NFL, the quarterback league. Those are the moneymakers.
All right. Well, listen, I got some good ones. Okay, so now this leads actually perfectly into the next piece. I want to talk about the Patriots and the Chiefs. Okay? So I'm gonna set this up because this lines in really well. So I kind of got lucky there. So I'm watching the game, right? And you know, football, when we play, right, and we practice, we're practicing as hard as we can against our offense, and the offense is trying to kick the crap out of the defense. But when it's game day, we're there to win together. Fair?
Correct.
And you know, you got to count on both sides of the field, right? Besides special teams. So they're watching the game. It's Kansas City. Obviously, Patrick Mahomes is playing, and everyone's always expecting everything, you know, 15,000 numbers and so forth. So the game was low scoring. So my question to you is, I'm just going to say it. My question is this, or my statement is, they were giving credos to, like, how great Belichick was preparing for Patrick Mahomes, okay? But I also kind of said, wait a second, but the Kansas City defense is led by Spagnuolo. And I don't know about you, but he's put together some pretty good defensive schemes in his history with the Super Bowl championship team, right? And so why is it like the guy who's used to always being the star gets kind of like Belichick had him in check as opposed to, okay, but the Kansas City defense did their job when they needed it to?
That's Belichick's been around. He's the man.
No, but what are your thoughts between the two, right? It's like the defense showed up for Kansas City.
Yeah, I think they're both great coaches, and I think Spagnuolo did an excellent job in preparing.
Byron?
Well, you figure, you know, I read his book now, Belichick, and he's been doing it for decades, like decades. You know, going back, you know, the Giants teams, even when, you know, the little taste that he had in Cleveland, you know, they were a highly ranked defense then, but that was run by Nick Saban was the defensive coordinator when he was there. So then with New England, look at the way he's adapted, you know, through the years with the salary cap and this and that. And he's like a chameleon.
Right.
He really is a Belichick, and he is probably the greatest, you know, NFL football coach ever, without a doubt.
Belichick's system works with whoever's in there. He never had like top level receivers. He would take these no name guys, Hogan, Edelman. They're 5'8", 5'9" receivers and make them superstars. Mm-hmm. And then when they go on to other teams, they're not as good as they were when they played on the Patriots. Because whatever,
like a lot of Dolphin players.
Yeah.
Dolphin players become really good when they leave. Yeah. There's like a ton of Dolphin players. I'm going to get in that Dolphins fans and go crazy. Look, I think Belichick is a great coach. In fact, I always give, you know, teachings or coachings on, even though I'm a giant, giant blue and red a fan, but I respect the organization of the Patriots, right, because of what they've done and how they people buy into their program and hold each other accountable. But I guess I was just saying, look, yeah, you held them in check, but you know what? They still won the game, and so you're not going to always win the game only on the offense. You may win the game on special teams. You may win the game. Games are won on defense. So I kind of was balancing the two just because, yeah, he did a great job on this guy scoring, but this ain't playoff time. We don't know what's going to happen. And we've already seen that guy come back from 20-point deficits. No problem. Okay? So, again, I'm just saying, look, there's kind of a balance there only because Kansas City defense scored on defense.
Yeah.
They did their job. Yeah. What was Mahomes? So I figure we take it from there. Ben, you there?
No, you're froze up on me, but I didn't hear what you said.
No, I was just saying that we're going to move on. But I was just saying that, what's Mahomes going to say? He's going to tell him defense not to intercept that and score so I could score the points on Belichick. He's just going to play the game, right?
Yeah.
And it's no different than defense, right? You're winning, and all of a sudden they fumble through an interception. You got to get out there.
Yeah.
So that was a pretty good – now I want to get into the Giants. Giants. Let's talk a little bit about these Giants. And, just so you know, last week, you were here, Benny. Byron was on the Danny Dimes bandwagon last year. Now I was making fun of someone who was like telling the Giants to tank for Trevor Lawrence. I'm like, can you believe who the hell would do that? He goes, oh, that was me.
Messed up.
So bottom line is, I'll let you guys go, but I just don't feel they did Eli justice last year. Let him retire. I'm okay with that. I just did not like them play it out, and I was vocal about it. I said it last year, and I'm not saying it this year. And Benny, as our guest, I'll let you go, and then let Byron, you're up next.
I agree with that. I think they should have let Eli finish out the season, let him retire, and not put in the new kid that quick, because you threw him to the fire and they don't have top-notch receivers and their O-line sucks. So you're putting that kid back there. I don't care if you put the greatest quarterback in the world. You don't have an O-line to protect him and he has nobody to throw to. He's going to be running for his life.
He got no runner either.
He got no running back. So, yeah, they need to build a support staff around him to help him out. If they don't do that, then I give him 2-3 years and he's gone.
Byron?
2 or 3. He's going to be gone after this year.
After we tank, right?
Trevor Lawrence. We're tanking for Trevor. Trevor.
Oh, my God. That's
the guy.
I wish I could have saw this. I would have been all over you.
I don't know.
If they don't let Eli fly,
we also have the Jets that –
Hold on. Let Byron go ahead. Byron, what?
They'd have let Eli play in that horrible offensive line that they had last year. They'd have been carrying him out in the body bag. He would have got slow. At least the kid can move around a little bit. Eli wasn't moving anywhere in any direction. He'd have been like the Statue of Liberty standing back there getting lit up every week.
I understand, but that two things just from me, it would have been his choice, so he would have known when to come out. One, and then two. I just kind of felt, even though he has not a good taste for the Mannings, that's Byron, and I just felt that Eli, even when he wasn't playing, was still helping him. Eli would have helped him along, and it would have taken him a little bit more time, number one. And number two, I had this conversation with someone today. He played at Duke. Like, okay, how many great quarterbacks came out of Duke?
Well, we did have Dave Brown back in the day. He came from Duke, too.
That's right. Yeah. The same Giants. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So, and Duke's a great school. Phenomenal. Basketball, nothing against their football team. But, you know, Brady got picked in the sixth round, but he came from Michigan. It was still a football school. Yeah. Right? I mean, it's a football school. So, and I'm not saying he couldn't do it. It just, that's where my issue is on that journey. And, you know, a lot of our friends up north were, put Danny Dimes in. And, yeah, he did good the first game. And that was it. So, I just kind of wanted to bring that up. And then, also, I just think that their defense is still terrible. Look at Jean-Paul Pierre. He's killing it still.
Yeah.
And I felt like he was with us when he was, like, yeah, I thought, how old could he be?
30. He's got to be at least 30.
It just seems like he's been in the league for a long time. He's doing well.
Yeah.
Yeah, but
he's pulling his fingers off, right?
Yeah. Playing with the firecrackers, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, you did? Oh, yeah. Okay, awesome. And then I'm looking at Daniel Jones. He's got like 2 touchdowns and 5 interceptions.
Yeah, but Eli had thrown a lot of interceptions in his first 2-3 years.
No doubt. Yeah. But I guarantee if you really check the books, he's not only does he have a lot of interceptions, but he should also be in the record books of most interceptions.
I broke up.
I've never seen so many tips from a quarterback that lands into the defensive back's hands. And he had a ton of those.
Right. Well, Brett Favre had more. He's a record holder.
Oh, for interceptions?
Yeah, Brett Favre was. Yeah, he threw way more.
Yeah, but he was a gunslinger. He would take his chances. He didn't care until the end. What were you gonna say about the Jets, Ben? You want to bring up Jets?
I'd say look at the Jets. They're not doing good. They might be looking to get Trevor Lawrence and get rid of Darden.
Now we're fighting against
Trevor Lawrence. There might be a lot of teams doing that right now. You know, they're starting to get a better front line. They still have crappy receivers, but you know, nobody to throw to. You got to get it all together. You got to get the receivers. You need the protection. If you don't got that, you're not going to do well in that league.
But we're in a time where, you know, you got the salary cap, you know, the free agency and, you know, all this other stuff that goes on. And you, like, a lot of teams are able to fix their problems like quick, but for some reason, the Jets and the Giants, it just never happens. It never happens where, you know, we're going to get a splash. We're going to hire this free agent guy, or we're going to get this guy in the draft. And for some reason, both teams always just flop.
They flop. Or they get a guy that's way out of his prime and maybe has 1 or 2 games and he gets injured and he's done. Yeah.
We do have Saquon Barkley. I mean, that's a superstar. There's no confusion there. Now,
yeah.
Now he's injured.
He's sitting playing Nintendo at home with his leg up in a cast.
Oh, man. So there's a lot of work to be done there. Same thing with Coughlin. I didn't want them to get rid of Coughlin. And I didn't like him until he won the Super Bowl for us. And then let's talk about the Cowboys. The NFC East is terrible. The top lead, the top team is 1-2. Like, the Giants are in half a game out.
Don't forget the tie that Philadelphia got. 1-2-1.
Oh, that's right. 1-2-1. But think about it. I want to ask you this question, Benny, because I think I know the answer, but, you know, I want to double check it from your professional perspective, right? Dallas should be 0-4. That onside kick, if I'm on the receiving end, the guy who can't really touch it is the guy kicking it, right? But the offensive side, I can land on it anytime I want.
Yeah.
Even, right? Or I could wait and get a penalty, but you'd have to kick it over again. So there was no loss. There was no risk from the Atlanta Falcons to just fall on the ball.
They should have just fallen on the ball.
But regardless of the 10 yards, though, is what I'm saying.
Right, yeah. Once that ball's kicked, they can leave the line and snatch that ball up. They can scoop it up and run it for a touchdown.
Right. It's only the defense who can't touch.
Defense can't touch it until it passes 10 yards.
That's special to team coach.
Can't block until it goes 10 yards.
That's what I thought.
But
like, I don't understand why didn't you just fall on the ball.
Well, then what happens is a lot of people don't know the rules. If you notice,
these are millionaires.
They don't know the rules, but you notice they kicked it away from the visiting team's bench. Uh-huh. And so that way the coaches from the other team couldn't yell at them to pick the ball up, jump on the ball. They kicked it to their own bench.
Oh, I didn't realize that.
Think about that. Yeah. No, you got to look at the nuances of the game.
So the onside kick was designed and kick it towards your own sideline.
Your own sideline, because now
your other team can't be coached.
Because your other not you can't sit there and yell and say, "Hey, dummy, pick up the ball or fall on it."
But there's like six dummies there.
Dad, listen.
Okay, be good. Be good. Just, you know, be good.
They're very gifted athletes. Sometimes they're not too bright. And sometimes
Byron's coming at you, man.
The little things in football that you think everybody knows,
they don't.
Some of the players don't know. It's like lining up on the ball. They think they can line up on the ball. And you have to sit there and say, no, you're in the neutral zone, so that's a foul. You need to line up behind the ball. And I've seen it in little kids all the way to practicing with the teams that I practice with. They can't line up.
But tell me, it's also you guys trying to get your edge, right? You're pushing that line to get as close as you can on the snap.
Yep. Oh, yeah.
Right, Byron? I mean, some of it is like not you don't know it. You know it, but you just want to know what you get. Like, you know, I play defensive back. I'm going to hit a guy and grab his shirt and pull him down. But, you know, as long as I don't get caught.
You know, playing, you know, the interior line like that, you want to get as much of the ball as you can get. I remember the big guy back in the day was Clifton Winfield was all over top of me about that. Yeah. He would sit there yelling. He yelled at me through high school the whole time. You know, you need to get up there, get as much of the ball as you can get. And then when I started jumping off sides, then he was ready to strangle me when I kept doing it.
But so we could put a perspective on Byron, right? What were you, 6'6"? What?
6'5". Okay. In high school or later on?
Yeah, just later. By your playing days. Playing days and weight.
I played at 300 pounds in college.
Okay. And 6'5".
Yeah.
And I just want to give the audience a perspective. He's a large man. When he's telling you, he's lining up. He's lining up.
And ran a 4.7840.
He ran
what?
4.78.
Really?
Yeah, I did.
Man,
that's a big boy. That you can't even make fun of him because he can catch you.
They measured the 40 short though.
No. That was legit. It was a pro day. It was pro day when I did that in Tulsa.
Oh my God, that's funny. Look at Benny.
I couldn't do that now. Yeah, you know, I probably get catched in my car. You know, and then, you know,
So what do you think is happening with the NFC East is so bad, and Dallas is still, you know, I hate talking about Dallas, but I'm kind of happy them not doing well. What do you think is wrong there? I mean, cause it's not like they don't have talent.
I think it's coaching, because they had everything put together. They had gotten the line. They got the receivers, and they got Prescott, who was a great quarterback.
And a running back.
Playoffs. And they had a great running back. What happened when they went to the playoffs that one year with that same team to the next? You know, it gets down to these guys are making a lot of money. They're like, hey, wait a minute. I might want to be able to walk and talk and not eat applesauce at 33 years old because I've had a brain injury and just – lay up and just take the money, and you know, could be that, could be, you know.
Yep. Well, you know, the funny part though is that remember, though, for me, this looks like a repeat, right? Just with different players of the Tony Romo era, right? Well, you know, Tony Romo was a really good quarterback. He comes in, he gets them as far as he can, and they just still couldn't go any further. And I think Dak's a great quarterback.
You got to look at the one constant, who owns the team.
Yeah, he's a problem.
What is his involvement in the day-to-day operation of that team?
Well, that's what I was bringing out, right? Because of
the same thing with the Giants, Will and Tamara, all those guys, pounding ground. We got to run, as the league developed into a passing league, they still wanted, you know, to run the ball. You got to adapt and come and move with times. It's a passing league. You need to get receivers. You need to get a good quarterback. You need a line to protect them.
And, right. And what are your thoughts on that, Byron, on you know?
I mean, you figure, like, you know, Jerry Jones is, you know, got to be, what, close to 80? He's probably, you know, winding it down where his son is doing, you know, a lot of stuff that he used to do. But then, you know, people also don't remember or, you know, forgot that the center, he retired. And with Travis Fredericks, I think his name is, he retired. The right tackle's hurt, Collins. I think the right guard is hurt. I forgot what his name is, but you have half a line, but then you also have a new coach that's coming in with a new system, McCarthy. Yeah, he wants to throw the ball. He's going to throw the ball way more than what Dak is used to.
They're putting up points, though. It's not like he's – they're playing offense. Their defense, I mean, they put up 40 points against Atlanta, and they put up another 30-something points, but they lost by – you remember the old San Diego Chargers? Remember with Fouts? He would put up, you know, 60 points and lose 65-60?
That comes down to what you said earlier in the broadcast. Defense. You need defense. You got defense wins the game. If you know Tom Brady could score 43 points, but their defense could hold him to 38, then you're winning. Well, Dallas that goes the defense.
Goes back to the city. Both sides. And they're deep enough, right, against the Pats. Actually, I'll lay off of that, but we'll go from there. Okay, so now let's take a little bit here. Connection, hopefully, a little technical difficulty. All right, so here I want to switch screens, and this is for my co-host, Byron. And who's that, Benny?
Who's that, Benny?
Byron Jones.
Yeah, whoa. Number 97. Look at the size of that guy. Byron, give us a recap with your thoughts today of this weekend's UCF-Tulsa game.
Oh, what did I tell you last week? What did I tell you? I told you, didn't I? 34-28. It was close.
Yeah, he did.
You also didn't realize that Tulsa was the last team to beat them. They beat them last year. They beat them in 2016, when, like, because they had a 21-game winning streak, UFC, well, UCF.
UCF. Mm-hmm.
They had a 21-game home winning streak, and guess who was the one to beat them back in the day? University of Tulsa. that's all I need to say.
Tulsa's coming back. Tulsa's coming back.
But this week, we're playing University of Cincinnati. I'm not too sure about that one.
help Benny and I out. What's happened? Let me move out of the way a little bit. What's happening in this picture here?
Well, that right there, that's my bestest buddy right there, Brian Brunner, right
49?
There. 49. And it was a fumble when we were playing the University of Oklahoma in Norman, Oklahoma. And that was one of the few times, you know, one of the few great things that we did, you know, that day. We lost like 28-15 or 28-18. Yeah, it was close. That was their first game of the year. That was like our third.
Nobody would know. You could have just gave us a great story.
Nah, I'm telling you, you know.
So is that you high-fiving, or is that you going after the ball? What's going on? That's after you got the fumble.
After the fumble.
Okay.
You see that tremendous vertical, you know, the first, you know, vertical there? I'm probably about 40 inches off the ground.
I see the shadows not even there.
And you remember the pony, pony sneakers or shoes back in the day?
The pony turf shoes.
Yep, that's what we had. Had hundreds of them.
Oh, my God. Can you imagine the turf back in the day, how much it would burn us, give us three-degree burns?
And, like, playing on this field at OU, it had a big crown on it because when he used to run the wishbone, but Barry Switzer was the head coach then, they always wanted to run to, you know, to the perimeter or whatever you call it, to the sideline because of the way the field – I mean, what crown. Because if you stood on one side and looked across, all you would see – was from the waist up. Yeah. That crown was that big on that field. Yeah.
Well, Tony Dorsett, your advantage then was coming down when you're older.
Yeah, running downhill, yeah.
Well, Tony Dorsett even said that those fields were made that way. That's why he always cut back because everyone was running downhill after him. And when he cut back, they couldn't stop on a dime and come after him.
That's smart.
He would always get extra yardage that way.
That's really well paid off for him. So that's interesting. So in other words, their own momentum kept him going forward. So right. Once he cut back, it was over.
Yep.
So they couldn't recoup the recuperation time, or what do you call it? Reaction time.
Yep.
Response time was a lot more difficult there. Anything else about you, Tulsa? I'll give you a Tulsa.
I just love Tulsa.
All right.
It was great to me. I was great there, in my own opinion.
Awesome.
I don't have any warrants or baby mama drama or nothing down there, so I'm all good.
We're proud of you, right, Benny?
You're
a pretty damn boy, High Panther, man. We're proud of Byron Jones.
I watched this game when he was playing with Minnesota Vikings when he got that sack in that game, too. I jumped out of my chair.
Right. So we're always rooting for you. So we're going to be wrapping this up. We'll talk a little bit about the NBA Finals, but I want to ask you. So we got, I think there's 5 or 6 undefeated teams, right? And I'll tell you who those are in a second. Of the 5 undefeated teams, and we can go AFC, NFC first, and then we can see the best out of all of them. So the undefeated teams that are left in the NFC are the Packers and Seahawks. So of those two, who do you think, which one's better? That's tough.
Seahawks,
why?
We've got Pete Carroll. That's the X factor, Pete Carroll.
I like the Seahawks, but I like Aaron Rodgers just with Green Bay, just because he's one of the best quarterbacks around.
Yeah, I got a hard time with this because they're both great quarterbacks. You know, I mean, I'm gonna keep going, but that's a hard one because I like Aaron Rodgers and I like Russell Wilson. I like Pete Carroll, but Aaron Rodgers is an example I kept throwing at everybody that he waited 4 years. He's got 4 years of lifetime and learning on him, and he's just fantastic. And he's fantastic playing his second year with the coach. In the AFC, we got 4. We got the Titans, the Chiefs, the Bills, and the Steelers.
The Chiefs are just Mahomes an animal. He could be looking this way, throw the ball that way, and you know it's just he's changing the rules with pass interference and holding and everything else, because we were always taught if the pass was to the left side of the field, you're not calling any fouls away from the ball on the right side. But with a quarterback like Mahomes, you don't know where he's going to throw the ball, so you have to throw a flag. So you're going to see more penalties in his games on defensive backs because he scrambles so well and he could throw the ball anywhere without even looking. So that's very, very tough. So I'll go with them because they're just dominant.
Byron?
Yep, same thing here. You know, as long as he doesn't get hurt, you know, knock on wood, he doesn't get hurt. They're the team to beat.
What do you think about what Benny said? As you know, we're now the refs have to be there. I guess your eyes have to be even wide open when you're reffing his game. Is that what you're saying? I mean, his game's a little more challenging.
Your eyes are wide open when you're doing every game, but now the philosophy in officiating is changing. You would never call, a hold or a penalty that's away from the play. Especially on pass plays downfield, you're not going to call a defensive pass interference.
Because it had no impact on the play.
It had no impact on it. But now with a quarterback, the newer quarterbacks that are coming into the NFL, they're taking that out of the game because they can throw anywhere, any place, anytime. And it's just, you have to change your philosophy. Would he have thrown that ball to that receiver if that foul did not happen, but he went across the field and went to another receiver and completed it?
Right.
So
now it's got to be – it's more on the perfection because now it can happen where before it wasn't happening.
Before it wasn't happening, yeah. Those staying up the pocket quarterbacks, they did their checkdowns and they were thrown, to the checkdown, and the guy getting killed downfield was never going to get called.
I'm going to throw one out there for Byron from last week. He compared Patrick Mahomes to Randall Cunningham.
Yeah, you know what? Randall was a good scrambler.
I compared them. I didn't say about scrambling. I'm saying compared them. Like, they were alike. That's all I'm saying.
I think so.
I think Randall was a great athlete. He was no Patrick Mahomes.
Remember, he was an All-American punter as well.
Yes.
Randall. He probably was just as fast or maybe even faster. Patrick Mahomes. You know, we have to clear that up.
Well, by the way, his mom wants him to be called Patrick. So, no, Patrick.
Well, tell her to come over here.
I'm telling Benny.
So, Randall Cunningham, my guy.
Okay. All right, but I can agree with you on this due to the fact when he played, they didn't have this type of offense in the NFL. Now the offense is geared for a quarterback of that talent and that ability. Back then it wasn't. So if you put Randall Cunningham into a system today, he may have be just as good.
We forgot that. Remember when
he played.
Remember that one when he played with the Minnesota Vikings, the numbers he put up? He had receivers.
Yeah.
A whole bunch. He wasn't here, the wonderful Philadelphia Eagles Stadium over here down the street, with the bum receivers that he had. When he played with the Minnesota Vikings, he lit it up that one year. What was it, 15-1 or whatever the record was?
I think. I'm not sure, man. I think he's going back and forth.
I got a question.
But I was going to say something regarding how the league has changed.
Yeah.
Go ahead, Ben.
Oh, Byron, how do you survive in Philly being a New York fan? Because the Philly fans in New Jersey are just so obnoxious.
Oh, they're brutal over here because I'm surrounded.
I know.
Both sides of the house, across the street. I got the big old New York Giants in the window. So, yeah.
It's like driving out of New Jersey Turnpike. Once you pass exit 7A, you're in Philadelphia country. They're Philadelphia teams. It's crazy.
Oh, yeah.
Cherry Hill people think they're Philadelphia.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
That's funny. I know I was going to ask. You know what's interesting? You know how you were saying also about, and then speaking of Randall Cunningham, and you were speaking how some people don't know the rules? You know what's amazing to me is how the rule existed, and it took for some athlete, usually a superstar, to make something happen that everybody goes, oh, really? We could do that? Because to me, I think Randall Cunningham was the guy who let everyone know, look, if I just get the nose across the goal line, okay, I get a touchdown. Because we weren't taught to. You were not allowed to extend your hand when you had the ball in your hand. You weren't allowed to do certain things, right? Don't jump over a guy. See how things have changed?
All you have to do is touch that white line. It's treated like a plate of glass. If the ball touches it, it's touchdown.
Right, but Cunningham, that all came to light that time when he stuck his hand out. Remember, there was Randall Cunningham that extended the ball.
And Aaron
Rodgers. What else did that?
Yeah, Aaron Rodgers does that all the time now. When he's running toward the sideline, right at the last second, he'll stick the ball out because he gets that extra yard before he steps out of bounds.
It's just some things that they're doing today, it's like so funny how it was anti what we were taught. Like, don't leave your feet. These guys are jumping over players.
Also, these guys are a lot better athletes, too.
Yeah, but they're all big. That is funny. So, okay, so then so Kansas City Chiefs wins it across the board over there. Okay, so now Kansas City Chiefs versus the Seattle. I'll agree with Kansas City Chiefs over there. So that's an easy one for me. I'm still want Brady to do well. Kansas City versus Seattle. Right now, the undefeated teams.
Kansas City.
Wow, what a major favorite. That's incredible. Okay, that's good. Alrighty, and we're about to – so I want to just get into this last piece here, and I know you guys aren't, the big basketball guys. You see, I wear my Miami Heat shirt.
Wear my Cobra Kai shirt.
University of Tulsa. Thing.
You got a Cobra Kai shirt on?
Yeah.
Is that – there's a show on there, right?
Yeah, I know. That's where I saw it.
Oh, I watched it. It was pretty good. Yeah, and then there's supposed to be a third season coming out. All right, well, we got the NBA Finals. Obviously, Miami Heat fan, and they're playing, you know, the supposedly scary, the Lakers. And I don't know if you guys have been following the series. So it's 3-1, but it was 2-0, and then the Heat came back to win. And Jimmy Butler, one of the stars on the team, had – a monster game, 40 points, you know, a triple-double, double numbers in points, assists, rebounds, and he was just like a pit bull. He bullied everybody, right? Then the second game, the Miami Heat had the ball pretty much in control, and in the fourth game, they had the game under control, and to some extent, like LeBron and AD didn't play like blowout games. But what bothers me, and maybe Byron, you could explain a little bit better, just because he played at that level. Like, what could take a guy from, and he still scored 20. What could take a guy with this sense of urgency and that craziness? And he played like a madman, and then not give that same type of peace, knowing that, you know, can't go down against the Goliaths.
He was tired. You know, he put up you know, these great numbers. 40, he was tired. That's all you can say. He was exhausted.
That's a good answer.
He's carrying these guys on his back and everything. He was tired.
That's right. Like, he played a lot of minutes.
He said, you know what? I think he played like 38 minutes. That's a lot.
I think it was 40 yeah. minutes.
And he was tired. That's the only way he's playing. And then, you know, the other ones, you know, they wouldn't pull, you know, their weight. And that was that.
Yeah, and we got one of our starters back. So we were missing a starter, Ben, like one of the centers. And he comes back, and we just, you know, we lost still before 5. It looks like 10 because of the last few second buckets. But just it was a little frustrating. The game's tomorrow, and it's either the Heat either win or go home, right? But they're going to have to try to beat the Lakers 3 times in a row, and that's going to be a little challenging. And I'll leave you with this last piece about the NBA Finals. As you're watching it, we all know LeBron James and Anthony Davis on the Lakers. And Anthony Davis, his first 2 games, was playing better than any basketball player I think I've ever seen. At a guy that's 7 foot tall. He was shooting threes. He was taking it inside. I don't think there's anything he couldn't do, right? And then in the third game, when they lost, and in the game before that, he didn't perform as well, but he did pretty good. But he was just absent. LeBron James, even though they lost, scored – he was 1 assist away from a triple-double, but he scored 26 points, which is sad, is that that's not a great game for him, but he scored 26 points, 10 rebounds, and 9 assists. He did his job. But the best part – so I'm just setting up the scenario here, right? And the best thing I seen was Jalen and Jacoby was AD just – handed the MVP trophy over to LeBron for having that lousy game. Because pretty much he was dominating and LeBron was okay with it. But he didn't come to play that day, and LeBron's coming to play. And Jalen Rose just had me laugh. He goes, he was like, here you go, LeBron. If they win, because I still believe my Heat will win. If they win, pretty much AD just surrendered the MVP of the NBA Finals. Any thoughts on that, Byron?
He is one of the greatest of all time, LeBron, possibly. And, you know, he's in the twilight of his career right now. So, AD probably felt bad for the guy. Like, you know, here you go. Go ahead, you know. I'm going to have a crappy game. You know, I want you to be the guy. So here you go.
Yeah, no. I just think he just still doesn't have like what LeBron had. So he just kind of handed it over. Well, Benny, again, I want to say thank you and thank you for your service to protecting, you know, great citizens of New Jersey, and obviously Byron as well for your service in law enforcement. We'd like to have you back again another time on the show, if you'd be welcome to come back.
I enjoyed this. I enjoyed seeing my old buddies from high school and college days. So I like that. Plus, I like talking to Byron. He's funny.
I got your picture. I have the picture. You sitting on the bench. Perk and boy sitting on, you know, looking like you're ready to kill somebody. I'm going to get it to you.
You're not right, man. We're live streaming. You just told everybody that you saw Benny sitting on the bench, right?
I was a freshman.
He was a freshman on varsity, and it was at the end of a game, you know, one of the blowout losses that we had, and you know, he got a chance. Matter of fact, he had a big run.
We won that game, and you yelled at me because I could have scored, but I got caught. It was against Sarahville. I had that nice run.
Yeah.
And he caught me from behind. He was some sprinter from Cervo. I think he was an Olympic bobsledder guy. And you were mad because they promised they'll take you to McDonald's if we score 20-something points. If we score over. And you, Glenn Davis, Glennie Richardson, a Boozer, Bojo all yelled at me because I didn't score a touchdown.
You should have scored.
I got caught. You didn't want the match for me.
All right, guys. Keep it in control. Just so imagine that back where we grew up, going to McDonald's was worth a senior beating up on a freshman. Just so we're clear. All right. Well, Byron, my partner in crime on our show, and Benny, we'd like to have you back, and we'll invite you back and give us some updates as the NFL progresses, especially with what's happening in the NFL with the COVID. That's going to start making some changes, and they're going to have to do something because it's starting to spread fast. You know,
they're up in the testing and they're trying to keep people safe. Your crazy governor in Florida, what is wrong with him?
Why?
He wants to allow 65,000 people into Hard Rock Stadium to watch the game this weekend. That's crazy.
I don't know. I can't tell, man. Yeah. I froze. Can you see me now?
Now you're moving. You're good now.
No, I wasn't aware of that. It's interesting. So he's letting them come in for the Dolphin game.
Well, that's what he wants done. I don't know if the Dolphin organization is going to allow that. Maybe they're going to keep it at the 25% capacity, which I think is smart because
that's about the size of their crowd anyway.
Yeah.
Oh, that's I'm in Miami, South Florida, and boy, they ain't gonna like hearing that. So, no, I don't know. I didn't know that. I've been more entrenched into the Giants and the NBA Finals. I mean, this is a great time of the year. The Yankees, but now the Yankees lost the game. You know, I don't know what's happening with those guys.
My Mets are playing golf.
I'm sorry.
And my Mets are playing golf, so
as usual. Yep. All righty. So again, thank you and welcome to for listening to the Victor Arocho Show, co-hosted with Byron Jones, and brought to you by the Sportscast. Please, you could follow us on Twitter at the Sportscast1, and please visit us on our website at thesportscast.net. Join us next Thursday at 8 p.m. Well, we may have some more special guests, and Byron and I will be going at it again. And Byron still has a prediction, Benny, that the Giants are going to go 0-16. Oh, and I'm telling him that's impossible. We got a bet going on, so he's only got – I got 12 more games. So join us next week so we can see – you're going to be a special guest, and we'll give you a prize if you're on the week that the Giants actually win a game.
Not win a game. Zero.
Thank you. Have a good night, guys. God bless. Stay safe. And we'll Byron, you and I'll catch up next week. And Ben, I'm sure we'll talk to each other soon. Love you guys.
Love you.
Love you guys. Thank you for having me.
All right. Be safe. Yep.